Italian.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Let's just
not,
keep it that
not
way.
Not Bava. It's
he made Zombie.
Fulce.
There you go. Sounds close enough. Really good. The only problem I have with this one is the creature that's in the bottom of the house is definitely recycled from City of the Dead, which was on the bottom of the house. And if you've watched City of the Dead, produced by the same guy, probably recycled the creature because it really was cool. And that is a very creepy movie. Imagine having, maybe not for us, but maybe you, Jim, having your house in the middle of a cemetery where your living room has a tomb in it. How would you feel about that?
I don't know if I would like that.
I mean,
depends who's in the tomb.
Well, the guy, the doctor, was in the tomb.
Well, that's what I'm saying. It would depend who was in the tomb. Now, this being Edgar Allan Poe's birthday, if the person in the tomb was the dead, who does he sleep in the crypt with? I'm trying to remember my Edgar Allan Poe. Remember the poem where his girlfriend dies, but it doesn't, you know, there's no problem because he still sleeps with her every night in the tomb by the sounding sea.
It's not Anna Lee.
Annabelle Lee. Yes. Thank you, Mr. Dot. Yep. You have rescued my brain cells. Yeah. Annabelle Lee. One of my favorite poems of all time. And Chuckles, it's something you should be exposed to.
I should.
Figure necrophilia.
He started it all right there. Here we go with this once again. But we're going to keep the necrophilia for the Haunted Cabaret, which is next.
All right, we'll hold off.
I don't want to scare the kiddos away. Maybe you guys do, but I need some up-and-coming chuckleheads. Don't want to scare them yet. Now, House of the Cemetery, like I said, awesome movie. I had the chance of watching this one called Brothel, and I really don't know what to think about this. It was literally a haunted brothel. TNA, somewhat. But this movie was all over the place. It was time jumping from beginning to end. And if you're me and you already have medication problems, following this movie is not going to be easy for you. Check it out yourself. It's worth free, but it's not worth paying for. And then the movie Hobgoblin. Do you remember that one in the 80s?
That one I vaguely remember.
I vaguely remember that too.
A very bad ripoff of Ghoulies. Very bad. I don't know what I was thinking when I rewatched that again. Probably trying to get some nostalgia back.
No. I'll tell you, nostalgia for the 80s can be a very bad thing.
It was.
I just don't do it.
I don't understand what I was doing watching this the first time and thought it was cool, because the second time around wasn't that cool. And then to wrap things up, one that everybody is on the fence with, it's either you really like it or you really hate it. And I'm going to say, as from my point of view, I really did like it. I, Frankenstein, very good movie in my retrospective. I could have done without the religious purpose of it, which I guess that's the purpose behind Frankenstein, is a religious part of that. But it was really cool having the demons inside there and the gargoyles and a totally different story. But the same sense, falling closest to Mary Shelley's Frankenstein that I've ever noticed in a movie, minus the gargoyles and the demon part.
I was going to say, I don't remember those in the original story.
No, but as far as everything else, really good with following it and everything. Have you ever caught any of those movies? Have you caught I, Frankenstein yet, Mr. Dyer?
No, I haven't. No, I haven't seen it.
Did George?
I saw part of it, but okay. I think I was half semi-conscious when I put it on. So it's no fault of the movie that I passed out.
I say watch it again. And speaking about movies, we're going to go down to a song right here that is very popular of what we're about to touch into, the paranormal. Let's go down to the Ghostbusters theme song here on Chuckles Crypt on RhodeIslandFreeRadio.org.
Strange in your neighborhood. Who you gonna call?
Ghostbusters!
If there's something weird and it don't look good, who you gonna call?
Ghostbusters!
sleeping in your bed. Oh, who you gonna call? Ghostbusters! I ain't afraid of no ghosts. I ain't afraid of no ghosts. Who you gonna call?
Ghostbusters!
If you're all alone, pick up the phone and call.
Ghostbusters!
I ain't afraid of no ghosts. I hear it likes to get us. I ain't afraid of no ghosts.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
Who you gonna call?
Ghostbusters!
If you have a dose of a freaking ghost, baby, you better call.
Best paranormal movies out there, in my mind. It was made for everybody, so everybody can enjoy it. And yet it still had that little element where it could still scare you. It had little parts of it. A little known fact a lot of people don't know out there is Dan Aykroyd was actually a paranormal investigator and still is to this day. And he came up with this idea because everybody was spoofing on him. Why not? Let's make a movie spoofing on it. They didn't think that it would come into this Hollywood succession that it has now. They thought it would be like this B-rated cult movie and fade the way of a lot of the B-rated cult movies. But it did not. It had the total opposite effect, and it blew up. Literally, the building blew up. You pencil neck. Can't say the rest of that. Now, we've come back from that. And, of course, Jim Dyer's to my right here. And we're going to talk about your grandfather. And pretty much he was one of the first ghost hunters to go around debunking things. And it's on paper and everything. Not only did he debunk things, but let the fans know. I don't want to take away your fame. Who was one of the famous people that he used to walk around and investigate the ghosts for?
He was an investigator for Houdini back in the day. Houdini, when his mother passed away, he wanted to be able to contact her. So Houdini went to different mediums and seances to try and talk and converse with his mother. And he found that a lot of people were faking it, a lot of charlatans, just taking the money and doing tricks and everything to make it seem like the dead were talking. And my grandfather was one of a few people who would travel around and go to the seances and partake in the seance. And then they would basically say that they have a message from my grandfather's dead mother, who was still alive at the time, and a voice would come, and the table would rise, and all the different tricks that they had. And my grandfather would figure out how they did everything, and he would write up a report to Houdini, and Houdini would come back probably like a week later with the newspapers and make it seem like he figured it out on the spot. But the basic thing was that Houdini was actually looking for someone to be able to talk to his mother, and he just got so upset with the fakes that he had people trying to expose the fakes.
It's good to have someone pull that off. People are still pulling the wool over people's eyes now. And it's so much easier now to fake a ghost sighting than it was back then, because this modern thing called a computer. A little story for you guys, way back yonder in my third resurrection from the dead. I too had dabbled in trying to fake the paranormal. Now there's a little lesson to learn in this one, because I had attached a flashlight to a very long and tall broomstick. I had colored out the lens bright red, so on the flashlight, so it looked like a red orb, and I had loosened the front of the flashlight's container. Now a lot of people, they fall for that on Ghost Hunters. You ever see that? The flashlight stuff? I don't want to get into that. It's a totally another thing. It's very easy to do. And I dressed my buddy in all black, and I had him run so quickly past the camera, so all you saw was this little red orb start at one end and go poop down the other end. Lesson to be learned, there was an orb that went behind him that none of us had put up there and was playing. So I think something was trying to tell us, say, you want to see the dead? Well, we're going to give you the dead. Keep playing with us. And, you know, the old saying, you play with fire, you're going to get burnt.
Don't mess around with us.
No. I actually did stop doing that not too soon after that and said, you know what, if we find it, we find it. No need to fake it. Not only was it dishonorable and it was taken away from the actual people out there trying to make this a legit science, but it was just foolish. That is one of the things that I will say this evil clown regrets doing.
This might be the first time in your life that you've ever admitted to stopping something foolish too.
Yeah, and I know. I'm used to clowning around. Now, your grandfather, not only did he dabble in the necros and the dead and all that stuff, but he also wrote quite a few books and
Yes, he wrote quite a few short stories, and he had published back in the day in Weird Tales, and he did write a story about necrophilia. It was called The Love Dead. I think that's what you were referring to.
Yep.
And that's one of his more famous stories. That was in the Weird Tales back in 1924. I have letters from the editors from Weird Tales that they didn't want to put it in there because it was so gross, for lack of a better word, the way he described it. But he didn't actually say what he was doing. It was more imagery. His wordplay was, the way he worded it, you had to think about what was happening. And at the time, the Indiana Parent Teachers Association, they took out an injunction to try and stop the sale of the magazine. And, of course, after that, it sold out. And it basically rescued Weird Tales because they were floundering right then.
And Weird Tales was one of the magazines that published a lot of H.P. Lovecraft stuff.
Yes, it was so the first magazine that Lovecraft was in. Yeah.
Your grandfather's writing there, a lot of people give H.P. Lovecraft, say that he helped C.M. Eddy out. Mm-hmm. I'm going to say it's the opposite way around. If he had not saved Weird Tales, maybe Lovecraft would not have had that platform to keep releasing his stories to.
Right, not just Lovecraft. I mean, Robert Howard and quite a few other authors too. You know.
And it is a creepy reading, by the way, and the pictures are pretty cool on the cover of the book. You explained to me that one of those pictures on the cover is you?
Yes, the book Exit into Eternity. I took a selfie back then in a mirror, and I created the cover, and I superimposed it over a graveyard scene. So, and I was kind of dressed up as the Grim Reaper. So, yeah, so it is me.
So you kids out there think you invented the selfies. You're dead wrong. Jim Dyer admits he invented the selfie with a mirror and a stick. And voila, we have the selfie. We didn't need no iPhones or fancy stuff like that.
Mirrors and sticks have been causing problems from, I don't know.
Yep. It doesn't cause me problems, so when they're attached to the bottom of my shoe.
I'm talking about...
When you're going inside the woman's locker... I mean, let's not go there. I would never do such a thing.
Well, I was thinking more along the lines of, you know, bending over that, you know, sticks and mirrors and.
I thought we were going another.
You're going there now.
I thought we were going a Breaking Bad way, but we can't go there either.